Welcome back. We'll look at where we started from yesterday, where we left off yesterday, particularly the two systems that I wanted to talk about, and the systems of the corbelling and the construction of massive masonry towers, particularly the Gopura. And in both these, we look at a few case studies which give us insight into the way these structures were constructed in India in the past and give us guidance on how we intervene today in the process of structural conservation. So yesterday we were looking at the way a cobbled vaulting system, a cobbled construction, behaves as against a true arch construction, and that's where we parted. So we'll continue looking at it, and the focus is on this system of construction called cobbling, right? So the fundamental aspect is, one, the way these two systems are constructed. In the true arch construction, you have a radial manner in which the stones are placed. You have the keystone that then comes in the true arch system, whereas in the cobbling arch system, stones are actually placed from the two ends. They offset to a small, to a dimension that's possibly less than one third of the size of the block, sometimes far lesser, and then they come and meet at the top. So you've got these horizontal joints as against the radial joints that you would see in a true arch system. So that's fundamental difference that you would see. So we've been examining these systems for some time, primarily with respect to problems cropping up in such constructions within a structural conservation effort. So our first engagement with this sort of a construction system was the Taprom temple in the Angkor Wat complex. So the Angkor Wat complex, group of monuments in Angkor Wat, it's not just the Angkor Wat, which is probably the most popular, but you also have many others, eight others, and one of them is the Taprom temple. The Taprom temple was one of the temples which actually all the temples had vegetation growing on them extensively after the during and after the Civil War. And when the International Conservation Committee started looking at conservation of the Angkor group of monuments, they decided that the vegetation would be removed from eight sites, but the vegetation would be retained in one of them. Then the world could see how vegetation had affected these monuments. So the mandate as far as Taprom was concerned was to retain the natural and the architectural heritage. And this was a big challenge. And India was the country that was chosen to take care of Taprom Temple. The Archaeological Survey of India has worked there for more than 15 years now and has done a marvelous job there. So IIT Madras was the structural consultant to Archaeological Survey of India and examined the problem of the vaults and the vaults collapsing in several cases. So an extensive study was actually carried out. We had at least a couple of masters by research students who worked on this. And what you see there is really some of the prototype, some of the examples that we worked on, the simple vault without aisles, a vault with aisles, which were basically corridors. And we were trying to understand how do these behave, particularly when you have roots growing under them. And the kind of vegetation growth was so uncontrolled, you had roots growing under these structures, trees growing on top of these structures. So the worst situation was of the roots growing right beneath the supports of these structures. And as the roots expanded and grew in diameter, they would actually create a rotation of the supports. And so basically the intention was to understand the effect of this sort of a this sort of an external load on the structure, and also examine whether many of these walls were actually pulled down during wars with the use of elephants. They would make the elephants tie ropes to the trunks of the elephants and get these walls demolished. So kind of examining what was really happening. So the intention was to understand what happens when the supports of these walls rotate inwards or rotate outwards. So when you're pulling it from outside versus you have a tree root growing from beneath, you have an inward rotation versus an outward rotation. So that was what was being examined. And from a research perspective, it was useful to understand what was actually happening there. But from an actual implementation perspective, the intention was to understand how to protect these sites. And you can actually see in this figure on the right how an internal support system was introduced. It was a temporary support system that was introduced. And what you see here is a big black object is actually the tree growing on top of it. So you don't have the mandate to remove the tree. So the tree will continue to grow, but you must ensure that people visiting the site can go safely in and come out, and you don't have a premature, a sudden collapse of the structure itself. So this was an interesting project by itself. For those of you who are at IIT Gandhinagar, I saw that the final project report published by the Archaeological Survey of India on the Taprom project is available in your library. For others, it's available for purchase, available at IIT Madras, and it's a very interesting project. There are a few publications on this as well by the master's students who worked on the subject. Okay, so that's where the interest comes from. And basically, we've been examining what happens to these due to inward rotations and outward rotations. And the way these actually behave under an inward rotation of the supports and an outward rotation of the supports is quite different, right? Very briefly, I look at the inward rotation of the supports. And in reality, that seems to be a more resistant mechanism. And what really happens is, as the supports start rotating inwards, assume that there's a tree root growing at the base of the support, and the tree root is enlarging in its cross section. This is actually akin to a rotation of the support of the base itself. So when that happens, and when it's inward movement, what's actually happening is, since you're bringing these blocks together, the tendency is to bring the blocks together, there's an increase in the lateral thrust. Yesterday we were talking about that thrust is getting generated in all these systems. Lateral thrust is getting generated. There's an increase in the thrust. So again, looking at four different positions, joints, A, B, C, and D, D being the one at the bottom, the axial forces due to the gravity is highest at the joint D and least at joint A at the top. And the original thrust, let's say the original thrust in the original configuration is H, as the inward rotation starts occurring, you get an increase in the thrust. So the thrust actually moves up. But depending on how much of frictional resistance is actually available in that joint, which is the strength of the system, the red line indicates the strength of the system, the shear strength shown as a trend between the thrust and the axial force. So the red line is the line of control. If it is on the line, it's okay. If it is beneath the line, it's good. If it's beyond the line, you don't have equilibrium, you'll have collapse. So what actually happens is, when the thrust increases because of the rotation, the inward rotation, you go to a situation where possibly one of the blocks reaches its limit. It touches the red line, one of the blocks, A, B, C, or D. A being the one where the least compression is present because it's right at the top. It probably touches the line and it starts sliding. And that's how you get deformation. Now you have a new configuration and there is further growth of the tree root. It moves further. The thrust increases again. And then possibly the next joint starts sliding. And so that's how the propagation is actually happening. Sufficient movement starts occurring at these joints, and at a certain point, you might have tipping or overturning of one of the critical blocks and it all collapses. So this is how propagation actually happens. At the site, we did not see this sequence. It's conjecture, but mechanically, we can model it in that sense. But our interest in this continues because we then started looking at other structures in the country which are corbelled actually. So that's what takes us to several other constructions across the country. The south is, Tamil Nadu is full of temples where you have the corbelling technique that is employed to construct these massive structures. Orissa, the Kalinga architecture, is actually based completely on the concept of corbelling. So let's examine the complexities here, and we'll come back to this basic problem of damage propagation or failure mechanisms in cobbled systems. So the world famous World Heritage Site of the Konark Temple, the Sun Temple in Konark, is one of these structures which employs cobbling extensively. That's a cross section of the, you know that the main temple of the Konark collapsed more than a century ago. What remains is what's called the Jagmohan. And what you see here is the cross section of the Jagmohana. And if you see, the one half shows you the elevation, the other half shows you the section. And if you actually look at the section, these internal areas that you see is all cobbled. And yesterday when I was talking to you, in the Jagmohan of the, you saw the cross section of the Jagmohan of the Puri Jagannath temple. And the ceiling is actually sealed off. But you should actually have corbelling in the interior. And it possibly is in this format. So you have series of these pockets where cobbling is, one, reducing the volume of material, and two, is creating a system that is resistant. Okay. And in fact, if you were to examine one of these pockets carefully, you actually have the nice offset that's created, the way cobbling is carried out. You can see it in elevation and in section here. And both in the Konark temple and in the Puri Jagannath temple, the ceiling is actually further supported with wrought iron beams. That's like an additional layer of support. And these are original wrought iron beams that are there in these constructions. So from Taprom to Puri and Konark, our interest started being focused in this particular situation, where the big concern was at the Jagannath temple, the Jagmohana of the Puri Jagannath temple, they started seeing cracks and spalling in the interior of some of these pockets, in the interior of some of these cobbled pockets. And that set of alarm bells, primarily because a century or so ago, the Konark temple collapsed, and the Jagmohan of the Konark temple has been sealed off because it started showing a similar failure mechanism. Beams started falling, and then there was alarm. So in 1903, there was this governor of the province there who decided to fill up this temple with sand, sealed off the doors such that you fill up the interior so that nothing falls down, and it's actually preserved like that for more than 100 years now. However, there is credible information to believe that the sand is now a few meters from the ceiling and is really not supporting the roof as it was intended to. So the fear in the Puri Jagannath temple was, are these telltale signs of an impending failure mechanism in the cobble vaulted systems? So we were asked to come and look at it. IIT Madras was examining these vaults, and we had to examine whether there is a safety issue in the first place, and whether some supports would be required, whether some intervention would be required. And while we believed that the system was safe, we carried out, we've started actually examining this problem in a much more basic sense. So if you remember what I showed you in the previous slides, that these systems, you have one layer of these cobble systems, just one single layer. If you remember the previous slide, we just have one layer of these cobble systems that we examined, and they are very sensitive to lateral support movements. Very sensitive to lateral support movements. And it again becomes sensitive, as I showed you yesterday, with a drop in the frictional resistance in the joint, you can start compromising the stability of these systems. So while under gravity, everything might look perfectly fine, any support movement and any loss of frictional resistance in the joints should ring alarm bells for these systems. But our approach to this problem was, look, the individual system with just a single set of blocks may be extremely vulnerable. But when these are seated within a massive construction, there is literally no space for these to move. And if there is no space to move due to lateral support movements, the vulnerability is significantly reduced. And then if it has to fail, the stone has to break and crush and fall apart. And probably that's the reason why these cannot fail so easily, but we needed to demonstrate that. So the research program that we've actually launched is to understand how these systems behave and how these systems behave in isolation and sitting inside these complex massive constructions. So very quickly, just a comparison between the two systems, the true arch system and the cobbled arch system. The resistance and the failure actually can be quantitatively captured by what is referred to as the cone of friction. And the cone of friction at every joint, you can have the cone of friction defined for the radial joints in a true arch versus the cone of friction defined for these horizontal joints in a cobble system. The cone of friction is nothing but the cone formed by the resultant of the gravity force, the axial force, which is the gravity force, and the friction caused by the thrust itself. So you have the thrust in the joint and you have the gravity force acting perpendicular to it. The resultant of the two is an inclined force. And if you take this inclined force and create a cone out of it, you develop it, create a cone out of it, that's the cone of friction. Now, this cone of friction is really the limiting cone of friction, which means I've created this cone understanding how much of frictional resistance is available in the joint. As long as the resultant is sitting, resultant in terms of the thrust that's coming onto the system and the gravity force that's acting at a joint, as long as the resultant is sitting within this failure cone, the system is stable. The moment it goes on the failure cone or out, you start having movements in these systems. Now, from the failure cone examination, it becomes very clear that the failure cone and the movement of the resultant within the failure cone is a much more stable process for a true arch system than for the cobbled arch system. The cobbled arch system, you can have the resultant slip out of this cone of failure quite easily. And that's the reason why when they are isolated, individual blocks, you can actually have significant movement, the one that you saw in Taprom, that cross-section which had fallen apart, is really telling you that these are very vulnerable. But the point is, in these individual isolated blocks, with so much of movement that is possible because of support translations or rotations, if I were to prevent that movement in some way, then you get a rather stable system. If I were to lock that and not allow these movements by placing this vulnerable system within a massive construction, then you start getting resistance. and it cannot move. And so finally, what would actually happen is stones will start breaking, stones will start crushing because they're not able to move and the thrust is developing. So if these movements are prevented, what sort of a failure mechanism can occur is what you see at the bottom. So examining this at a very fundamental level, what we have actually launched at IIT Madras is, I have one of my PhD students working on this, is to look at this prototype, look at the cobbling system in isolation, and understand if you were to move the support, if the structure, if the foundation of the system were to move for any reason, or if it were to rotate, move inwards, translate inwards or outwards, rotate inwards or outwards, or uplift or sink, what sort of failure mechanism can you see? And then, after that understanding, extend this to a more complex model, but that model would be a computer-based model. The calibration of the simple model with the physical tested model in a laboratory will happen as far as the simple model is concerned, and then the complex model would be on a computer. It's something that we're examining now. So what you see here is one of my students' first test setup, where you actually see that one of the supports is on wheels, and using a mechanical system, she gradually moves the system, moves one support. So you've got a lateral spreading of the system to see how the failure propagation actually occurs. So that's the location where the movement is happening. And then we've looked at outward movement, inward movement, rotation of the support, inward rotation, outward rotation. And then we're looking at uplift and sinking. And finally, we're also interested in looking at what happens if there is an out of plane or out of plumb movement along with an inward movement. So in two directions simultaneously, if there's a movement, what could happen? So that's this setup that she's developed. It's made out of, it's a physical model of the prototype from the taproom construction. So we are using granite here, and we've got these dry joints instrumented, and she's been running these tests. Since you've got maybe 20 blocks sitting there, it's impossible to put so many sensors and measure all the movements. So she's using cameras to record displacements digitally. So all these blocks have several points. And so let me see. Yes.
In these monuments, what was restricted, the lateral movement of the support or the movement of the sections in the upper part of the prototype?
In which monuments?
In all the monuments, like you said, if the quadrant section is isolated.
Yes.
It has a tendency to fall in.
Yes.
So when they built it,
yes.
What did they restrict? The
No, there was no restraint. There was no restraint. It was, for example, if I take taproom, if I take the Ankur constructions, they would just be placed and stable under gravity, right? The moment there is some lateral movement, as I explained, due to the roots or any other, you start seeing movement in these structures. But since these were isolated blocks or just one layer of blocks, this was how it was behaving. Now, when this sort of a system was not one single layer of blocks, but actually an entire construction, which is massive, you didn't have a possibility of these blocks moving outwards. You don't have a possibility of these blocks moving outwards.
So basically the lateral movement was not restricted. It can still happen, but the subsequent effect was constant because there were these sections.
Yes, yes, in a way, that's what. What causes these movements could always be there. There could be an earthquake and you can get lateral support movement due to that. You could have a massive excavation right next to this historical structure and there will be lateral movement of the soil. So the source of the problem could crop up at any point in time. However, the system does not have the degree of freedom to actually start moving.
But how did they ensure
move.
Move and there are restrictions, then there would be vibrations.
So. Exactly. So the point is this. The most susceptible mechanism is sliding of these blocks or overturning of these blocks due to lateral spreading. And at some point, you'll lose equilibrium. Now, if that's restricted, it will start depending on the strength of the block because it will start exerting stresses on the block. And then it depends on the tensile strength of the block or if it's strong in tension and there are points of stress concentration to compression, you can get local crushing. So the mechanism of failure starts changing, but these will happen at a much higher stage of lateral thrust, not as low as the one that you would see with these individual set of blocks. That's the fundamental difference. That's the fundamental difference that we see. Yeah, so I think we shouldn't be spending time on that. In the end, if there's possibility, I can show you the video separately. So what really transpires is we are applying this sort of mechanical support movement, and at different frames, you can actually see the propagation of failure. And finally, so in this particular example, with outward movement, we have the initial geometry, and in about actually 180 frames, and we've taken one out of every 10, you have the formation of the mechanism and collapse. So we've been doing that for inward movement and outward movement and so on. And so we now have a fairly good idea. See, earlier we had examined, as far as taproom was concerned, only computer models and assuming that that's how it actually works. But here we now have a physical model and we have calibrated the computer model to what's happening physically. You actually see on the left side the moment in which you have the failure mechanism generated. You have the failure mechanism generated and the computer model now actually captures it almost perfectly. And so we've done a calibration finally of how the system is expected to function. So now we have some critical information that we can use to work on more complex models. So now we'll be able to demonstrate how a more complex model should actually behave because we have some confidence on how the basic model is going to be functioning. So this is how we proceed with this sort of a study. Okay, so that's as far as the constructions, the complex constructions are concerned, because it's very interesting. You actually have a very vulnerable system, and definitely the ancient builder has seen this vulnerability while constructing it. So it goes through a process of iterations, a process of improvement. But the final outcome, if a structure like the Konark Jagmohana or the Puri Jagannath Jagmohana has to be constructed using such a fragile system, it's simply because you've really understood what can eliminate the weakness from the system, and you now have an extremely stable system that is the load-bearing system of these constructions. So you see an example of a fantastic construction technique which does not require the use of centering. The cobbling technique does not require the use of centering. You get this massive construction made in a very simple manner, and you have a way in which the weakness has actually been eliminated because of the kind of massive construction into which these systems are seated. So if there are mechanisms that are taking it towards failure, it's actually going to be cracking of stone and crushing of stone, and we need to keep tabs on that. So I think there is a better understanding of how these systems behave. It's important, for example, you have iron, you have these wrought iron beams that are sitting inside, and it's important that moisture is kept away because corrosion in these can actually crack the stones, and then weakness in the cobbling system can be generated. So I think such studies will eventually lead us to conservation protocols for such complex systems. But as you can see, we are on the path of trying to understand such complex constructions from the traditional methods of construction in our country. And there's so much more to be studied. And the lack of number of hands to do this sort of a work is really slowing us down quite a bit. So it's an area that really requires a number of people to work in. Okay, I'll move on to regular domes. So the regular masonry, the true arch construction itself, and the true arch construction, the arcuate system that is used to create domes, and a particular problem that is inherent in the in domes. Okay, and the reason why I'm touching upon this is one mind-blowing construction that dates back to the 13th century, which identifies this problem bang on and has a solution. And today we would construct it no different from the way it has been conceived 700 years, 800 years ago. Okay, so if you're looking at a dome, and the dome as something that's created by developing an arch 360 degrees, and you get the dome. So if you're using a true arch system and you develop a dome, you're getting the true dome, which has this arching action that keeps it together. However, domes, because of its geometry, actually have a certain weakness, and particularly when you construct them with materials which are weak in tension, right? And brick masonry or stone masonry is weak in tension, good in compression, weak in tension. So what really happens in this type of a construction is that if you take a hemispherical dome, merely under its weight, merely under its self-weight, or sometimes you have superposed lanterns on top of these domes, so merely under its self-weight, it has a tendency to just sit down. It just open outwards, okay? Think of it as a rubber ball, and you slice it, it's just hemispherical, apply force on it, it just tries to open outwards. That's the tendency any dome will have, irrespective of the material. And when it does that, you develop two kinds of actions. And the first one is along the meridian, along the meridian, you actually have compressive stresses. It's carrying its own weight, it's compressive stresses, and it's compression all the way down. However, because of the three-dimensional effect, along the rings, along the circumference, you actually develop what is called hoop tension in the lower 60% of the height of a hemispherical dome. Okay. In reality, if you take the hemisphere with a collatitude of about 52.8 degrees, beneath that you develop tension, and above that, it's fully in compression. So what actually happens is the dome in its upper part is in compression in both the vertical and in the circumferential direction. And compression is good for masonry. So the upper part is free of any distress. But the lower 60% of the height actually has vertical compression, but along the hoop direction, along the circumferential direction, you have tension developing. And this tension in a material which is poor in tensile strength actually leads to formation of cracks. And so you'll have the hoop tension direction and cracks forming perpendicular to the hoop tension. And those cracks are referred to as meridional cracks because they run along the meridian. And these meridional cracks, if you observe them carefully, would actually stop at about 60% of the height, because beyond that, it's all compression. So the dome can actually split up with these meridional cracks. It's actually splitting up into a number of arches. The arches themselves are stable, but you can have ingress of rainwater, and you can have problems of deterioration over time. So this is how a dome, actually a hemispherical dome made out of the true arch, would actually behave. And hence, in the past, after such constructions were made, cracks were always noticed, and there were different ways in which the ancient builder used to counteract these. And one of the most simple ways was to go and put a steel, an iron ring or an iron chain a series of chains on the exterior in the zone where it's expected to crack or has cracked, so that you have a tensile resisting material. In some other constructions, the Colosseum, for example, in Rome, you can actually see that the cross section is massive at that zone and becomes thinner and thinner as you go up, so that the weight of the dome is reduced, but where you need material, because tensile stresses are expected, the cross section is increased. So there are various ways in which these have been counteracted. Therefore, if you come now to this construction, this is in Karnataka, present day Karnataka. The town is called Arasikere, and Ishwara temple there. You have this structure, it's circular, and the dome is constructed in a very unique manner. The entire construction is about 5.7, less than about 6 meters in diameter. However, so what you're seeing is a cross section of this structure. You have the dome there, the hemispherical dome, support system, and a raised plinth. Now, what's interesting is you see a set of belts there, right? Can you see that? You can see there are some horizontal elements and there are some vertical elements. We'll go zoom into it a bit. It's very interesting to see how there was an understanding that you're going to get significant thrust. And if you look at the plan, you can actually see how a second layer of columns have been provided to counteract the thrust that's coming from the dome that is supported on these 8 columns. So the dome is sitting on those central 8 columns. You have significant thrust, and that thrust is now counteracted by a second layer of construction in a very elegant manner. And we'll come to these ribs. So what's very interesting is you can actually see that you have a tie system that has been created in stone. Okay? So the possible sequence of construction is that the meridional ribs were erected in stone. Okay? So you have these intersecting ribs. There are 16 ribs. The 16 ribs are erected. They are like arches. They're all placed. And then they already have carvings there so that they can interlock with anything else that's coming in. So you already have the meridional rib that is under compression stabilized at the bottom. Because of its own weight, it has stabilized. You then build the first layer of first ring, the first horizontal ring that actually goes and connects with each of these ribs, interlocks in stone and holds it together. And then the second layer is constructed, and then the third layer is constructed. So you've actually made a skeletal framework for the dome, right? And then the stone slabs are merely infill panels, and the dome is complete. So this is, and then from the outside, you need to ensure that water doesn't seep in. You've got lime concrete layer, and the dome is finished off. So it's an amazing construction. Yes. Yeah.
So why are these belts all around the dome?
So actually, it's lower 60% that actually that would have a problem in the hemispherical dome. So these two ribs should actually do the job in the portion that we're talking about. And this is more for stability of the framework. So the framework, when it's made, the skeletal framework, when it's made, is not a dome completely. That skeletal framework should have sufficient number of intersecting elements to hold it together as a three-dimensional element. So it's from that perspective that the three layers actually work, and then you also get a symmetry, and you can fill slabs more easily because you've got smaller areas to be filled in with slabs. So it makes sense to have series of them, but the real work is possibly being done by the two lower rings. So that's the dome. You can actually see those beautiful rings. Those are the three layers, 1, 2, and the outermost. And then those ribs that kind of hold it together. So it's prefabricated construction, you can call it, prefabrication, and then very stable system. And if preserved well, if maintained well, you have all the reasons to believe that this can actually continue. What's mind-boggling is there's a clear understanding of how the forces are flowing in this sort of a system, and where is the weakness, and what is required to actually take care of this sort of a system. And you know there is going to be tension, hoop tension. So you need to be careful about the type of stone that you're using, because stone in tension is not necessarily strong. So you need to choose a stone that is sufficiently strong for the kind of work that you're doing. The tension is going to be there and requires a good choice of stone itself. This is the dome from the exterior. So you can see that it's finished off with lime concrete. And that's the second layer of columns, whereas the internal column is the one that is actually holding the dome itself and then creating the thrust on the outer layer. Okay, let me now move on to towers. Okay, and talking of towers, when you're constructing masonry towers, and when these masonry towers were constructed in the past, did they have structural analysis programs to determine what should be the actual cross section? What was the basis? What was the scientific rationale with which a certain cross section or a certain material or a certain geometry was chosen is always a question. So trying to understand, do reverse engineering and understand why cross sections were the way they are for a given condition gives you a pretty basic understanding of how was it perceived, how was the combination of forces perceived. So what is a simple technique for calculations, for understanding such systems, is called the thrust line analysis. So I'm not going to go into the specifics of thrust line analysis, but thrust line analysis is a very powerful, simple analytical method, which is used to understand the line of action of forces within a system under the combination of gravity and lateral forces, right? You have self weight acting in the gravity direction, and you can have lateral forces. Could be wind forces, it could be earthquake forces, which are also lateral forces. So under a combination of gravity and lateral forces, the thrust line analysis is a very powerful analysis method that pinpoints to you what could be the potential line of action of forces within a system. It's very useful for walls here, subjected to wind forces and gravity. It's very useful for arches as well, and the thrust line analysis is used for stability checks. So if you were to take this sort of a wall, and this is an example from Mesopotamia. So this is Ctesiphon Palace cross-section actually, but I'm just saying this is something that can be demonstrated easily with this sort of an example. In the middle of a desert, it has it's subjected to wind, desert storms on the windward side, and on the leeward side, it's the interior of the structure, and you have gravity forces. It's very instructive to examine this sort of a cross-section and understand what was the rationale of having a 5-meter base. So the base cross-section is 5 meters, it tapers to the top of the structure. Was there a rationale for dimensioning this sort of a system? So if you examine this construction, you can take different sections and do your equilibrium calculations on this, simple statics. You examine this under a situation of no wind acting, and the resultant due to just the gravity would actually be collinear with the weight of the structure itself, and the base is going to be completely in uniform compression. But the moment there is wind load acting on this system, you've got wind load and you've got the gravity forces, there is a tendency for the resultant to get pushed towards the leeward edge. So this is your windward side, that's your leeward side, that's your leeward side. The wind load acting along with the gravity has a tendency to push the resultant, which was earlier at the centroid of the cross section, causing uniform compression at the section, to become skewed, and you have possibility of overturning of the system, more compression on one side, less compression on the other, and the resultant actually starts getting pushed. You can see that the resultant has now gone from the center towards the leeward edge, and that's actually changing the way the that cross section is, it's changing from uniform compression to non-uniform compression. So this is very simple equilibrium calculations, and what these calculations can help us do is identify at any cross section where is this resultant acting if you know what is the wind force and if you know what is the weight of the structure. So at any section, I can go and mathematically calculate where is the resultant passing through. So if I take 10 different sections, I get 10 different points where the resultant is expected to pass through, connect all of them, I get the thrust line of the structure. Now this thrust line should lie within what is called the kern of the cross section, which should lie within the middle third of the cross section. And we saw that yesterday. In the arch, you expect the resultant to be within the middle third. If it exceeds the middle third, you actually start getting cracking or tension in the cross section. There are few assumptions here. I'm not getting into those details. You keep everything linear elastic, which is not really how the material might behave. But this is a rather robust and good method for checking the stability of such systems. So what would actually happen is when there is no wind, you've got uniform compression at the base of the structure, but as the wind load keeps increasing, you've got the compression increasing on one side and slowly reducing on the other side. And then you have a limiting case where there's no more compression on one end, which means the cross section is ready to uplift. You keep increasing the compression, you have no contact in one part of the cross section, you've actually got a crack that has progressed, only part of the cross section is in compression, and finally the material may just crush and you'll have overturning of the entire system. So this is how these structures would failure propagation would happen in this manner in these constructions. So as long as this resultant is sitting within the middle one third of the cross section, you will have a situation where the entire cross section is in compression. And that's what you want, because you're working with a material like masonry, and compression is good for masonry. You want the entire cross section to be in compression. So if that is what your limiting situation is, and if your resultant is actually popping out of the middle third, the only option you have is to increase the size of the base, increase the size of the cross section. You can bring back the resultant into the middle one third. And that's been the guiding principle for dimensioning of walls in the past. Interesting deduction from reverse engineering, but that is useful and can be applied to any masonry tower, any complex geometry with some simplifications and idealizations. And that brings me to this form, which is the temple gateway called the Gopura, which is a part of the temple architecture of South India. This is the entrance gateway of a temple. These are multi-tiered constructions. You can have 3-tiered, 5, 7, 9, 11, 13 being the tallest. So the tallest in South India is the Srirangam Rajagopuram. It's called the Rajagopuram because that's the Raja. It's the king of the Gopurams. A temple can have a gopuram on its four cardinal directions and in as many concentric circles as you want. So some temples have extensively large number of these gopura. You can see the Madurai Meenakshi temple. There are many of them in concentric circles. Even the Srirangam temple has several of them. And there would be one which is actually the tallest and the most important and referred to as the Rajagopuram. So the Srirangam Ranganatha Swami temple is the tallest, 13 stories, but mind you, finished in 1984. It was left incomplete for almost 300, 350 years and completed in the 1980s to its present height. It's at 72 meters. The Meenakshi temple, about 52 meters. The Ekambareshwar temple in Kanchipuram, 59 meters, 11-storied, a 9-storied Rajagopuram here and an 11-storied in the Meenakshi temple. So these cross-sections are very interesting to study, to examine their stability. And again, we've actually started examining them because many of them have problems of structural deterioration, and that's how we've started examining them. But it's been a very instructive exercise because there's so much of traditional knowledge that's gone into conceiving this sort of a massive construction. So I'll take you through one recent, I would say last 4 years we've been working on this, fantastic learning experience that we've had with a temple in a town called Tiruvellare. And for those of you who can pick up parts of these words which have some meaning in Tamil, Tiruvellare, Tiru is anything that is divine, refers to the divine presence, and Vellare is white stone. Okay, so this entire area has outcropping of granite and a white variety of granite, and that's how the place gets its name. And the temple is actually situated on a rock outcropping, Tiruvellare. So the way we got involved in this particular project is the temple, which also happens to be one of the 108 Divyadeshams. There are 108 Vaishnavite sites of importance, and this temple is one of them. In fact, it's linked to the Srirangam temple. It's close to the Srirangam temple, and it's an important Vaishnavite site. It has an incomplete Rajagopuram. It actually has no Gopuram. And the Rajagopuram at the east, at the northern entrance, is incomplete. And the temple and the people in the immediate vicinity of the temple were interested to take this forward and complete this today, right? So the construction stopped possibly 800 years ago. And it was being constructed during the Hoysala period. And there is there's something recently that we've noticed, and it's the kind of sculptures that are there in the interior are exactly similar to the ones in Badami. So there is really evidence, historical evidence of works being carried out by different regimes in different periods. So it's historical evidence. However, during the Hoysala period, due to some wars, resources had to be moved away and the work was unfinished. So what was meant to be a seven-storied, seven-tiered Gopuram stops at ground plus two. And so it has one stone level. The lower portion is always in stone. It's called the Kalkaram. And Kal is stone. So the lower portion is always in stone and granite in this case. And the upper levels are normally in brick masonry. And two brick layers have been constructed. So it rises to a height of about 17.5 meters. And additional five layers are being proposed to take it to the completion. What you see here is a cross-section of what's existing versus what is proposed. So we were asked to look at it and say if the existing structure is actually capable of taking the additional load, because you're talking of a material that has been in service for 800 years with all the deterioration that could have happened due to environmental factors. So that's how we came in and started examining the problem. So strictly speaking, in engineering terms, a feasibility study of structural expansion of the structure or structural completion. So we did our investigations because we need to start with information from the site, and we, as I said, are not educated in these traditional knowledge systems and have no clue how these were constructed, how deep should the foundation be, what is the composition of the wall, what's the morphology of the wall. So we use present day tools to go and understand what's the cross section, what are the layers, probably even drill through, take material and understand the layering of the walls and so on. So you can see some of our team members here carrying out GPR on the floor, GPR on the different levels, a trial pit to understand up to what depth has the foundation gone and so on. So the whole process of gathering information that will be useful to do reliable calculations to arrive at the feasibility of expansion of the structure itself. So what was most crucial for us is to understand the cross-section of these walls and how are these walls constructed. And these walls, okay, it's granite from the exterior, but it's never going to be granite through the cross-section, because you're talking of cross-sections which are about 4.5 meters in cross-section, right? The Srirangam Rajagopuram that I showed you earlier, the wall cross-section is 12 meters, okay? Now, is it 12 meters of solid stone? No, it just cannot be. I mean, it's very rare that it will be something of solid construction. So it's definitely an infill material. Now, what's the infill material? What's the core material? Is fundamental information, because if I were to make calculations, I should know the strength of the core, I should know the strength of the exterior leaf, and that's how I should be proceeding with the with a set of calculations. So since we didn't have information, we had to take a core through this construction and arrive at what could really be the cross section in terms of dimension and get an understanding of the wall morphology. So it's really classified as what's called a three-leaf construction. You have the outer and inner leaves in granite blocks, and then the core, which is poorer material, which is in Tamil Nadu, most often it is broken bricks, lime concrete, mud, sometimes broken pieces of stone, but it can vary from region to region. In Andhra, some of these are filled with sand. So the idea is to get a full cross-section so that the stresses are distributed, but it doesn't really matter if it is going to be the same material. That's the reason why they use a different core material. And world over, this is how massive cross-sections are made. The Tower of Pisa, for example, the marble that you see is 20 centimeters thick. And what is inside is again poor core infill material. And was also one of the reasons contributing to the complexities due to the complications due to the tilting of the structure itself. So you can see the core being taken and being studied. Yes. Used to? Yes. Economy. Just economy. Because imagine 12 meters of cross-section. You have to go quarry so much of granite and come and fill. It's rather have the granite sit there in the quarry rather than bringing it and making a mountain here. So it's uneconomical. It was uneconomical in the past. But the whole idea was you needed a cross-section. You could have weaker material on the interior. I'll come to that point in a moment. So based on the cross-section information that we were able to gather, we were able to arrive at a conjecture of how the cross-section could be. And since we were drilling only at one or two locations, we were actually able to get the actual measurement at that location. That doesn't mean that another location would have exactly the same measurement. So you needed to have some sort of a range. So we looked at a lower bound and an upper bound of how this cross-section would be. It already gave us a lower bound and an upper bound estimates for the structural calculations. So this is a conjectural drawing of how the cross-section would have been. So you have the infill material, and then you have the outer leaf and the inner leaf. But let me tell you, by the time we arrived at this stage, we were quite convinced we're looking at a very, very stable cross-section. Because those of you who are from structural engineering background here, you will agree with me that a hollow cross-section is an extremely stable cross-section as against the solid cross-section. So the whole idea of being able to articulate a hollow cross-section here and have these two C-shaped elements, you can actually see that it's two C-shaped elements that are holding the entire tower, and tapering as you go up gives you such a stable system, gives you an extremely stable system. So that's where we were. And then we carried out our structural analysis. We looked at what is the situation in the structure with the existing weight, how is it weathering the existing weight, and then if you were to add those five little stories which are tapering and reducing in cross-section as it goes up, what's the situation? So we did this set of calculations, and we kind of understood how the structure is expected to behave in the current conditions and after the addition of several stories. So our role was really small. We were just looking at the feasibility, and it looked like the structure can easily take the load that it was supposed to. It was originally intended for, but 800 years later. And very interestingly, we carried out what's called a pushover analysis. Normally a pushover analysis is done in the lateral direction, like an earthquake force acting on it. You can do a pushover in the gravity direction, which is nothing but I keep pushing the structure till it fails. And we were amazed to see with the material data that we had used here coming from the structure itself, because we had done some tests on the structure continued to be stable, and we had to stop our analysis to almost three times its total weight. Yeah, three times over you could have the structures loaded, and it still was safe. So these are structures which are extremely robust under gravity loading. And that was a cause for concern, because it may be good for gravity loading, and those working in the field of earthquake engineering, this is always a concern. Everything might look perfect and safe under gravity. A little bit of lateral shaking in an earthquake, things might fall apart. So then our intention was, okay, let's do a lateral load analysis, an earthquake analysis on this, though we are sitting in low seismic zones. But if you are projecting structures to stand there for 1,000 years, you should be careful that it can be subjected to probably low to moderate earthquakes. So we did a lateral load study on this, and the structure actually had very good behavior under lateral forces as well. And this is owing to the shape, the geometry of the structure. This, the C and the hollow cross section really makes it a very robust structure, tapering all the way up with a massive base. We had good earthquake performance in this sort of a structure. You can see this is getting pushed in one direction. We did multiple combinations, but I'm telling you, you get very, the kind of behavior that you get is something that is desirable behavior itself. So we originally did it for the existing structure, and then we said, okay, now let's load it with the new portion and let's see how it behaves. And we had satisfactory performance. And so from a structural engineering perspective, we actually gave the green signal to the extension of this construction itself. So this study has been very useful for us, because if you remember when I started speaking yesterday, I talked about the collapse of a gopuram close to Tirupati in a place called Kalahasti, in the Sri Kalahasti temple. It was a Vijay Gopuram, a 7-storied construction. We were, as IIT Madras, involved in the post-collapse investigations of the structure. It actually split up. You can see a vertical crack in the structure. It split up, and in a matter of few days, the crack kept growing and it collapsed. Our post-collapse investigations were quite extensive. What we were able to arrive at was, at some point in time in the 1960s, the floors that were present at every level. And if you remember what I had shown you yesterday in terms of Madras terrace construction with timber and brick flooring, was present at every layer. Now the timber might deteriorate over time. So there's a tendency to go in the recent years to say, look, the timber is deteriorated. We can't get timber. It's expensive. So take it off and put a reinforced concrete floor. So in this particular structure in the 1960s, the timber floors and the brick layers on top were all dismantled, but unfortunately, probably the executive officer who was in charge of the work got transferred, or they ran out of funds. They just removed the floors and stopped. Now, in a hollow construction, the floors have a very important role to play to just tie the walls together, because a tall, slender system can actually, under lateral action or even under gravity, have a tendency to dilate, to move apart. And if it does in a low tension material like brick masonry, you can start having cracks. And the absence of the floor actually contributed to this sort of a deformation in the structure. And the collapse investigations actually detected that about 15 months before the collapse, this crack had actually fully developed. And in the days after those months, they had actually painted the structure and filled up the cracks, which aggravated the situation, and in a few months was almost in an irreversible situation. So the missing floors contributed to the failure mechanism. But in the 1990s, someone realized, oh, we were supposed to put floors here, and they went in and put very heavy reinforced concrete floors. So in a deformed structure, when they went in and put further loading, you actually had an aggravation of the problem. And so it's a set of cumulative effects that finally led to the failure of this structure. We actually had a video. Someone had taken a video on a mobile, few minutes, about 28 to 30 seconds, before the whole thing came crashing down to the ground. What was remaining after a few minutes was just all this rubble that you can see. But it was very clear from the video that the collapse started around the fifth floor and then brought the whole structure down. What was remaining was only the stone base in the structure. So it gave us this study on the Tiruvallare temple structure and the post-collapse investigations. We were able to join the dots and have an understanding that what's very critical in the reconstruction of, on the completion of this structure, is to ensure that the ties at the different levels have to be executed in a formal manner and ensure that they're there forever. So this work is, this work will possibly happen in a few years. Currently, all that is happening is there is still no permission, legal clearance to complete the structure, but the existing structure is being consolidated. There are cracked beams, there are damaged portions which are being consolidated so that the life of the structure is, the deterioration is slowed down. So a few days ago, this was on the 23rd of January, a very important event happened, which was what's called Nelekkal Sthapanam, which is one of the important stone beams in the interior, which had deteriorated extensively and had cracked up, had to be replaced. So one of these stones have actually been put in position. And this is a photograph from that day from the exterior. You can see a crane sitting there today. It's probably, it's not easy to actually take beams in and out of an existing structure. Logistically, it's a nightmare. You've got beams that weigh 22 tons that actually have to be taken from the exterior, inside, from inside, dismantled and taken out. And we were talking about the fact that the number crunching, the logistics and all that is fine, but the Indian architecture, the sacred Indian architecture, there's something more that we really sometimes would miss, but is so integral and central to the whole process of designing and construction and art and sculpture and everything. So a colleague of mine, professor from IIT Jodhpur, was at the site along with us that day, and she had casually taken a photograph from the exterior as this function was about to begin. And we really didn't see anything at that point in time, but when we came back, we were traveling back to Chennai, and we looked at the photograph, and there was an eagle, there was a kite flying there. And this is a Vishnu temple, and as you enter, you have a Garuda there, and it was, you know, it gave all of us goosebumps and reason to believe that there is divine presence, and the Garuda was flying there, protecting the whole activity. We will see how this progresses, but this has been a beautiful learning experience. The last thing that I want to talk about is something that I started when I talked about the mandapas, and that's the recent unfortunate incident that happened in the Madurai Meenakshi Sundareshwar temple, which is again a world famous temple constructed over several centuries. What you see here is a plan of the temple, and thanks to Google, you can get a perfect plan today. You can see what is happening there. So you see the nice gopurams, the massive gopurams, they're 11-storied gopurams. And then we are talking of the Sundareshwar Shrine, which is the Shiva. So Meenakshi Temple is a temple dedicated to Lord Durga, and Sundareshwar is Shiva. So you have the Shiva temple here and the Meenakshi temple there. Right in front of the Sundareshwar shrine, aligned with the Sundareshwar shrine, you have the mandapam, referred to as Veera Vasantarayar mandapam, which was constructed by a Vijayanagara king, the brother of a Vijayanagara king, Vasantarayar. And that's the focus of this part of the presentation. Right next to it, so you have the Sundareshwar shrine, and then across you have the Vasantarayar mandapam, which is aligned. You have the Nandi, or the bull, which is the vehicle of Shiva, in the middle of the Vasantarayar mandapam. And this structure was built about 500 years ago. And right next to it is the world famous 1,000 pillared mandapam. This has 900 and odd pillars, I think. I've not counted. And as I said, sometimes above 50 is referred to as 1,000 pillared mandapam. So that's the Ayyarankaal mandapam, a very famous structure. But mind you, this structure was built only about 100 years ago. It was constructed in the early 1900s. But it's one of the most exquisite constructions you will ever see in this part of the country. So the temple itself dates back to 1100 AD, and the Nayakas of the Vijayanagara period have actually added several layers to this temple. Today it's a massive temple. It's a beautiful temple. It's a very clean temple. It actually won the, awarded the Swachh Bharat temple site last year. It's a beautiful temple. So the Vasantarayar Mandapam, as I said, was built by the brother of Tirumalai Nayak, who has actually built so much in South India, in Tanjavur and other places. It's a hypostyle hall. It has 107 pillars. But what actually happens is many of these are mandapas that are around the main temple. And so traditionally, several activities have been happening there. So what you see here is another mandapam in the Madurai Meenakshi temple. It's called the Pudu Mandapam. And it's full of shops, okay? And traditionally also in the past, space was allotted to few people living around the temple who were people involved in commercial activity. They could come and sell their things, flowers and puja items and so on. But today you get everything. You get plastic replicas of cell phone covers, ornaments and clothes and whatever you want is available there. Even Vasantarayar Mandapam, the mandapam that we're talking about, actually had 40 shops legally sitting inside Vasantarayar Mandapam and operating. And the Pudu Mandapam is again a 400-year-old structure, so beautifully carved, but you can't appreciate anything because you've got these shops with partitions that have blocked off everything, right? There was a fire. And that's where it all begins. The fire starts one night on a Friday night after 10:15 in the night, after all the shops are shut and people leave. And you know that, you might know this, you might not know this. In South India, there's a practice of removing the bad eye, but with the use of a pumpkin. So at the end of the day, the pumpkin with a lit camphor on top of it is used to ward off the evil eye. And at the end of the ritual, the pumpkin is just thrown on the ground and just disintegrates. The lit camphor escapes, okay? And if you're lucky, it's just lying somewhere and just burns out. But if you're unlucky, it could go into one of these shops. And that's what happened, because the CCTV camera had recorded it very well. And you could see that people have done this puja and they've left, all the shops are closed. And then smoke starts emanating from one of the shops. And then there's panic, people are running around calling people to come and start helping. It's late in the evening. There's a fire engine stationed in Madurai Meenakshi temple, but it didn't have water. So you know, these are problems that are, it's easy to say, come on, it should have had water, but that's how things are. So when God tests you, you had it. So this fire starts here and then engulfs almost 50% of the structure. Since the shops contained significant amount of plastics, and this mandapam also had a lot of wood that was being stored after a temporary mandapa was dismantled after a function, you had enough and more fuel. The fire went on for 5 hours. They could not tame the fire for 5 hours. The firefighting started at about 10:45, and it was only by 4 o'clock or so in the morning that they were able to completely tame the fire. The reason was they were dousing the fire with water, but the plastic had reached such an elevated temperature that the firefighters would move away to another zone and this would auto-ignite, and the fire went on. The fire actually was controlled when two portions of the slab just collapsed, because it was like a furnace. It was continuously getting heated. Two parts of the roof collapsed, and then the fire actually, it was a fuse. It really helped in controlling the fire, but that's what actually happened. And so the an investigation committee, as usual, was instituted, but we had this 12-member committee that was instituted, was looking at the problem from different perspectives, from the temple building, temple architecture, or the Sthapatya Veda. So there was a Sthapati, there was a sculptor, a Shilpi, there were engineers from the public works department, there were structural engineers, there were archaeologists from the Archaeological Survey of India. So it was a 12-member committee examining it from all perspectives to understand a few things. I'll just show you a few pictures and then take you through the process rather quickly. So it was nothing like we had expected when we were called to inspect the site. It was like a zone that was subjected to bombing. You wouldn't expect granite to, I mean, you think it's like stone, it's stone. How would you expect stone to just fall apart? And the biggest experience was to see the stone in melted form. So if you actually look at these are rectangular cut beams, but they've actually changed their shape. They've become like plastic. So the kind of damage that granite undergoes beyond 1,000 degrees centigrade or any stone is that it melts. And scientific analysis was done to prove that the temperatures uniformly exceeded about 650 degrees centigrade. So this was the kind of collapse that we had seen. And when things fall, there's sudden jerk, there are columns that get cracked. You can see these are sculpted portions of the column and it looks like melted plastic. No? There is disintegration of stone. So the fundamental concern was, what about the neighboring structures, right? So right next to this was the 1,000-pillared mandapam. The 1,000-pillared mandapam is world famous. And if something had were to happen to this, it would be such a big problem. So fundamental concern was, what about the surrounding structure, particularly the 1,000-pillared mandapam? And what about the residual strength of the existing mandapam? Columns have not fallen yet, and you have 107 columns here. Are you going to be able to reuse that mandapam, or should you be pulling the whole thing down? So there was a fundamental dilemma here. We had Agama experts, or the people who work on temple, the pundits who are assigned with temple rituals and who have learned the temple rituals, and their immediate concern was anything that's affected by fire should be completely removed. So so the scriptures actually, with reference to the idol, say that if there is a fire accident and the clothes that you use to cover the idol catch fire, you cannot keep it, you must discard it. But there was no part of the written scriptures, the scriptures that actually say that it is extendable to the built form as well. So the archaeologists who were on the panel, we're of the opinion that no, you cannot pull down the whole thing. You try and see how much you can retain. And so that dilemma of one part of the committee saying that, look, you need to pull this down, you need to construct something completely fresh, versus another part of the committee that said, no, you cannot do that because there is historicity. This is something constructed during the Nayaka period. Authenticity is important. You can't, you may be able to construct a beautiful mandapam today, but you might be wiping out history. So there was this dilemma. And in this context, our center was given the responsibility of examining it scientifically and seeing whether there is a middle path. whether there is an alternate path. And so we did a very extensive, we were given, you know, in all these conditions, when you have political pressure, you know, the chairman of the, the temple actually promised that the whole work will be completed in 6 months. The new mandapa would be available in 6 months. The chief minister and the cabinet had visited because it's a very important site in Tamil Nadu. But that means you have to clear the whole site, you have to get new stone, construct in 6 months and cut the ribbon. Would that happen? So it took a lot of convincing that, look, we're nowhere near that. And so I think when good things happen, you should really talk about them. And I can very proudly say that in this particular case, the committee and the temple administration and the administration in Tamil Nadu gave the committee and the people working on the scientific aspects ample time to do due diligence and come up with clear recommendations. And the best part is the recommendations are accepted. So this is definitely a rare case. It could have gone any other way as well. So the big question was, okay, if you really want to retain, how much can be retained? Because it's all subjected to fire, it can fall on your head, right? So that was where we started. But the immediate concern was the neighboring structure, and it was abutting the structure. And the 1,000-pillared mandapam actually had a connection in the sense, at some point of time, they said, okay, if you're walking from Vasantarayar mandapam to 1,000-pillared mandapam, you can get wet because if it's raining, or if it's too sunny, you'll be exposed to the sun. So they built a nice, they put slabs and covered the space between the two mandapas, they connected the two. Now, when you connect these two, and if something were to collapse in one of them, it could actually damage the other. Or if you're dismantling, it could damage the other. So we had this fundamental problem. And so the first thing that we did was cushion the 1,000-pillared mandapam as much as you could. And we did that with whatever was available. You see sandbags here, you see rubber tires that were put in place, because you're talking of pillars that are heavy, 10, 15, 20 tons that are going to be moved if they have to be moved, and it could be a big danger here. So you can see these pillars had to be wrapped with cushion and foam, and you've got these rubber tires. And why? Because all this is going to be carried out with heavy cranes, because you're looking at very heavy construction. So the investigations began. We had a four-level investigation. We did a thorough visual investigation. And in this exercise, the sthapati was also part, because the vocabulary of the different parts of a structure is something that we are not very familiar with. We had the sthapati working parallelly in visual condition mapping. We then did non-destructive testing. We primarily used ultrasonic pulse velocity. The infrared thermography didn't give us enough results. We then did lab tests on materials extracted from the different parts of the structure, very badly affected by fire, mildly affected by fire, moderately affected by fire, and not affected by fire, to kind of understand how it has weathered. So micro-analytical studies were carried out. And finally, on collapsed portions, we actually carried out destructive tests. We took out samples from collapsed portions and carried out tests. So this work was extensive. It took us 6 months. They said the new mandapam must be up in 6 months, but our assessment itself took 6 months. But so you see, we classified each structure into no damage, minor damage, moderate damage, major damage, and extreme damage categories. We did that for columns. We did that for the beams. We did that for the slabs. And you can see, if you look at columns, beams, and slabs, you can see that as far as columns were concerned, almost 45% of the columns were moderately to severely damaged, and almost 75% of the slabs were severely damaged, moderately to severely damaged. So we were looking at a situation where almost 50% of the structure would have to be pulled down. The non-destructive testing and all the other material tests were conducted extensively on different parts of the structure, and we finally arrived at our conclusions. And it was very interesting. It was a big learning experience, because we were able to link up the visual assessment to the results that were coming out from the non-destructive testing, to the results that were coming out from the destructive testing. Just to summarize, all these showed that the core of the granite columns were intact, were really not affected so much by fire. And that is simply because you're looking at a material which is of very low porosity. Granite is of very low porosity, and granite from South India is very good quality granite. Because of its low porosity, when it is subjected to fire on the surface, the temperature gradient across the cross section is very steep. The surface reaches 600 degrees, 1000 degrees, whereas as you come to the interior, the decrease in temperature is very steep. That conserved the core. But because of a steep temperature gradient across the cross section, the material was flaking, and the column that you saw with a lot of layers missing is primarily because of the steep temperature gradient. But all tests confirmed that the core was intact, and structural safety was something that we were able to assure because of the core being intact. And the study actually concluded that those structural members that were in the minor to moderate category should be salvaged, should not be removed, and new construction need not come there. Only for the major to the severe damage category, you should remove them. And as you remove, you have to be careful and to ensure that you don't damage the other parts of the structure. And so the major and extreme categories were removed, whereas the minor to the undamaged minor to moderate should be retained. And that path was accepted because scientifically it was demonstrated that there is a middle path. So the current status is it's been dismantled. So of the full structure, about 45-50% of the structure is dismantled. This is a picture that I showed you earlier to explain the different parts of the beam, because you can't see it in cross-section anywhere else. But a very thorough job of temporary supports and management of the resources, including heavy machinery on the site, was possible because of a very efficient temple administration and leaders from the temple side in this particular case. That's the temple, that's the work in progress, and the dismantling work is complete. New stone has been identified, again through a scientific process, and probably soon the reconstruction work of the collapsed portions is going to be carried out. So this has been an immense learning experience, particularly on the fire behavior of granite, and also on how easy it is to dismantle these monumental constructions, because they've just been placed together, gravity. You can dismantle them, reuse parts that are in good condition. It's a very sustainable construction system, and the work is now waiting for the stone to be quarried. It'll take some time, but again, this possibly will happen soon. So that is an amalgamation of the modern engineering understanding of structural behavior, materials, but definitely required feeding into the traditional knowledge systems as well. And the outcome is just possible. The outcome was possible because it worked well together. We worked well together as a coordinated team itself. Thank you.